listening to 98.3 FM, WRLR LP, Round Lake, Illinois.
Carniccioni's New York Style Pizzeria in Antioch at Routes 83 and 173 is another proud sponsor of WRLR Sports. Carniccioni's pizza dough is made from scratch using a family recipe that originated in Brooklyn, New York. Their dough is proofed at least 24 hours. Carniccioni's menu includes pizzas, calzones, pasta, much more. They have dine-in, carry-out, and delivery. Their number is 224-308-1499. Patriotism is like charity. It lives in the heart. FH Windows and Remodeling in Antioch wants to thank the military for standing tall and fighting for the red, white, and blue. Bold stripes, bright stars, and brave hearts is what this country stands for. America without her soldiers is like God without his angels. We don't know them all, but we owe them all. Patriotism. It runs deep at FH Windows and Remodeling in Antioch. We live in the land of the free thanks to the brave.
When I'm under, I'm weightless, floating away, and all I think about is doing it again.
Michael Swan is under the influence of his volunteer swim coach. Spending a little time coaching, he helps Michael stay off drugs. Be a coach, a mentor, a volunteer. No matter what it is, you have something to offer. Log on to helpyourcommunity.org or call 877-KIDS-313 and be an influence on the kids in your community. Brought to you by the Office of National Drug Control Policy and the Ad Council.
WRLR is community radio.
I feel much more informed with what's happening today.
When we say community, we really mean it.
It's not like corporate, and it's just a good station, you know?
We don't belong to some large corporation that makes a profit from this station.
Because I like the diversity.
And listeners won't be forced to listen to large blocks of advertising. Operations at community radio stations are made possible through grants and underwriting from companies within this area of operation. And donations, funds, and equipment, services, and time from area residents who volunteer their time to get involved.
It's as if it's my next-door neighbor talking to me, only he's on the radio instead of next door to me.
Real people just like you.
I like them. They tell it like it is.
Local focus, local news, local music, of the local people, and by the local people.
It's different than the rest of the stuff I hear.
I love the show. I listen every day.
WRLR.
You're listening to 98.3 FM, WRLR LP, Round Lake, Illinois.
Welcome into the Sports Corner with the Sports Guys for a Saturday morning, bright and sunny Saturday. Hey, Christmas is around the corner, even though it feels like spring. Oh, a lot to talk about on the show here this morning. We'll talk about where the Bears are at, or where they're not at for that matter. Packers going to the playoffs, we'll talk about that. The NFL will make our picks and our battle of about five games sitting between first and last. And only a couple weeks left of the regular season and the playoffs. Playoffs? Oh, sorry. I had to use that. We'll talk about college football coming up in a bit. We actually had a team from outside of Chicago that won a bowl game last night. Kevin the Swamp Rat will run that down. Other bowl games. We'll talk about, believe it or not, not only that, we'll find out who the next head coach is for the Carmel Corsairs. It's already been decided. He'll join with us after 9 o'clock this morning. We'll also run down all the other high school games from last night, including the game we had here on WRLR, and tournaments, holiday tournaments. I can't wait to see that. We're also going to catch up with Ashton Rotman, a former intern now working up in Milwaukee, talk about the Milwaukee Bucks, the way they're playing. Big win over the L.A. Lakers the other night. And believe it or not, we're going to try to find Mike McCarthy, because where in the world is Mike McCarthy? He is on vacation, but we're going to find out. We're going to really call him. I have no clue where he's at, to be honest. He was throwing out some food recipes or food places in Atlanta the other day. Now I have no clue where he is. I've lost him on the compass. I'm sorry. I hate to say it.
He was at the Waffle House.
Well, no, he was at a really good barbecue place in Atlanta. He was showing that off. Some really good food there.
Well, I got to do a food show, I'm thinking.
Yeah, no kidding. Hey, we got in the studio Don Johnson.
Good morning.
We got our big buddy Bruce here filling in for
Mike.
The fourth peel.
The fourth peel. And Bruce Becker with us. And we'll get Steve Brandy on the phone momentarily. I'm Rusty Silver. Good morning, guys. And my first question to you guys, and I asked this the last couple of weeks, are you done with your holiday shopping yet? Let me know.
Yes.
Are you waiting for, like, Christmas Eve to get all those great deals?
Of course.
Oh, my goodness. Done? Why would you do that?
I'll be home for Christmas.
Why would you wait until Christmas Eve to do this?
Because we pick names and I don't have to do a lot of shopping.
Well, that's a good thing, but...
And we're in the era of the online shopper now.
Well, yeah, but the problem is, you go online now, will you get your gifts that you want to get for somebody by Monday or Tuesday if you do it now?
Yeah, but the thing is, you got to put it on express if you're a last-minute person.
No worries.
Yeah. If you just have to have it there, you pay for that delivery.
I only need the one gift.
I'd be worried about that, trying to do that for Monday or Tuesday. It would scare me right now to wait that extra day or two.
You scare easily.
Well, yeah, but would you count?
Nervous, nervous.
Yes. Yeah, but then again, Amazon might work in a day. It's possible, but they've been hit with so many people. You've heard about that, right? They've been hit with a lot.
But they expected it.
Well, yeah, they do expect it sometimes, but I don't know. It makes me cringe. It's like, I'm getting nervous. I got to get this gift in by Monday or Tuesday.
You are supposed to be happy about the holiday season with no worries.
Oh.
So breathe deep, my friend.
Hey, I'm very happy when we don't have to see, all the snow that we haven't seen. This is just great. So.
Well, just enjoy this because you're going to get yours.
Yeah, we're going to get it back when we hit to January. But, let's talk football, guys, because the Bears' season gone. They lost to the Packers last week.
A game they probably should have won.
They had a chance to do that. I love the ending, the last play.
That was good. That was it. They almost made it.
I got to. You're right. They were a few yards away.
If that Ivy League educated tight end would have shared the football, they would have won. Because they had two. He had two guys to his right.
But they still had the 2-point conversion. And you know what a disaster that can turn into.
They wouldn't have won that. They would have a chance to tie the game in the final stretch.
Yeah.
And force overtime.
Chances are when you make a play like that, you're going to win. It's a momentum-driven thing.
That's interesting. I wonder if there's any statistics on that.
Yeah.
About you're hard enough.
Yeah, that would be good.
You're waiting for the band to come on the field, right, and have a crazy finish like that?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
I remember that.
Cal.
Yeah.
Cal and Stanford.
That was just a couple weeks ago, by the way. If you remember that. That was just a few...
actually, it was a couple weeks.
Decades. That was the anniversary date of it, so...
Yes. We're just poking you a little bit.
I know you are, so... But the Bears, I hate to say it, last year they overachieved. This year, everyone had these expectations. Oh, they're going to go to the Super Bowl. Come on, guys. I mean, how can you expect the Bears to go the distance this year? And I said this, I remember starting from the beginning of the season, I was so worried about Fangio going to Denver, being the head coach there. Yes, he deserved the opportunity. Chuck Pagano, everyone's going to sit there and say, oh, it's Mitch Trubisky, it's Nagy. It's the defense. Yes, they had injuries. There were a lot of problems with this defense this year. They didn't have the year like they had last year. They didn't have as many takeaways. They didn't get to the quarterback as much. And that put the offense on the field a lot more, and they didn't show much. Sure, you had injuries. Everybody gets injuries. We all know that. But I just don't think the defense showed me the likely ability that they could be that good.
Come on,
like
Rusty.
They were last year.
Come on, Rusty.
Okay.
Come on, man.
I'm glad you mentioned that.
Exactly.
And it's strange because I've did all my statistics last night.
He was ready for you.
I was ready for that just in case you brought it up.
And
here,
I did.
Here is some defensive statistics.
Let's hear that.
All right. Total defense for the Bears this year, number 8 in the league.
Thank you.
Last year, first.
That's right.
All right.
Against the pass, 13.
Yes.
Last year, 7.
Yes.
Against the run, 6. Last year, 1.
You are filling in for Mike McCarthy, aren't
yes,
you?
Yes, I am.
Feeding us the stats.
Points against the defense, 3rd.
Mm-hmm.
Last year, 1st. Here's the big one. Interceptions, 25th with only 8.
Uh-huh.
Last year, 1st with 27.
Yeah.
And sacks this year, 13th. Last year, 7.
Right.
So there's your defense. So don't forget, that's pretty good considering the massive amount of injuries.
Oh, yeah, they had a lot of injuries this season.
So I expect this to get a lot better next year.
And it's not only the number of injuries, it's who the injuries occurred to.
Roquan Smith.
Roquan Hicks. Smith, your fastest linebacker, your best defensive tackle.
I mean, those are your team leader. Those are big.
The year before, we talked about this. They didn't have injuries to key people on the team.
Right.
Everybody stayed healthy.
That's the whole the same thing with the Cubs in 16. No injuries.
Yeah. And so that, to me, is the wild card. I don't think Chuck Pagano, I think he did a fine job.
I think he did okay.
I hate to say, we'll grade in a couple weeks. I'm not too big on Chuck Pagano being the defensive coordinator. But you're right. Injuries could lead it to an incomplete situation that kind of curtailed the defense. Let's bring in Steve Brandy. Good morning, Steve. How are you doing this morning?
Good morning. Beautiful morning on this winter solstice. Great to be talking with you guys.
We're talking about the Bears, and I jumped on the defense, if I may here. You know, that was part of the story of why the Bears didn't make the playoffs this year, where a lot of people had thoughts they were going to go to the Super Bowl. I know a lot of us that were smart didn't think that would happen, but a playoff was a possibility going into the season. But your thoughts, I mean, I leaned on the defense right away and jumped on that. What did you see about this team?
Lack of ability to make big plays. I have a very bad habit where every year for the Super Bowl, I pick a team that is up and coming and just came up short. The automatic assumption, they're going to take the next step, and that doesn't always happen. So my pick for this year's Super Bowl was the Chiefs and the Bears, thinking they both take the next step. Chiefs haven't been as good as we thought. The Bears just took a huge step backwards, and that was it. Lack of ability to make big plays. We're talking offense. We're talking defense. We're talking getting outthought by the other team. If you ask me, the one little play that sums up the whole year was the loss to Oakland in London, where there was that penalty that made the Raiders have to kick again. Remember, 4th and 6 became 4th and 1, and I thought, they're not going to punt again. They're going to go for it on 4th and 1. They better be ready, and they weren't. The Raiders did a short snap, got the first down, went on to win the game. That sums up the whole season. The Bears were not ready. The Bears were outfought and outplayed.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you know, you guys had mentioned earlier that you thought that maybe some of Nagy's play calling and situational football wasn't maybe as good as it could have been. But I think a lot of that had to do with his lack of faith in the quarterback position. And I think he shielded him when he was hurt. And obviously that hurt the team by not letting him do what he does well, which is run the football. We saw what a difference it made when he started to run the football, when he rushed the football in situations where there were lanes, running lanes for him to do that.
Well, it's funny you should mention that, because another statistic on the rushing this year versus last year, and probably a lot of that has to do with Trubisky. This year, they're 29th in the rush. Last year, they were 11th. And I know the 400 yards that Trubisky had last year probably had a lot to do with that.
You betcha.
And the difference between, you know, Howard and, I don't know if that's a difference or not.
The only thing is, the injury to Trubisky, and I still say this, when he came back, he was not in full form until the last couple weeks. We've seen more mobility out of him in the last 2 or 3 weeks than what we saw when he came back for the first 3 or 4 games on his return with the harness. He looked a little bit fragile out there, like he didn't want to run with the football. When you see him run and get mobile and get moving, this team works differently, a little more cohesive. There's actually a better offense when he is moving around to make something happen.
Well, the threat of running always does that, because the quarterback is always going to have open lanes, especially if you have an athletic quarterback. Those lanes are always going to be there for him to take advantage of. But the key is can he do the other phases of the game? Throw the short pass that threatens them downfield, the short to medium range pass to the tight end, to the running backs out of the backfield. We didn't see any of that. We've virtually got nothing out of the tight ends all year until the end, and the young guys did step up, so there's some bright spots in the tight end position. But Trey Burton got hurt. We didn't see from him. He was very effective last year. He's like a wide receiver getting downfield at the tight end spot. And then the running game, you know, that was suspect. We really didn't get a lot out of the running game like we thought we should. some of that had to do with the offensive line, a depleted offensive line that didn't really protect
them. Yeah, guys, there were personnel decisions. We all know there was a major personnel decision that hurt the running game. But with the offensive line, you know, how many times in the history of the Bears have I wanted them to trade down for more picks and use them to build a better offensive line? They need to get some more linemen in draft and build them up. And then the execution of having a quarterback that should be able to run, a lot of times he would roll out and he looked scared. It's like, okay, I got to get over here before I get killed. Okay, now what am I going to do? It wasn't roll out with execution. It was roll out running for your life. And you could tell. That's what they've got to fix. Last year, it was roll out with execution. This year, it was, all right, what am I going to do?
Yeah, it wasn't. You could see his decision-making was definitive in these last couple of games. He looked like somebody that was dedicated to his decision. And other times, he looked like he was unsure. I'm running the play, but I'm not sure that this is the right play to run.
Well, I have a couple of issues. Rusty, just maybe one issue is something you said about Trubisky may have been hurt. And that would have been okay with me, except when I saw Nagy go back those first four series against the Packers to the old playbook again. That makes it a little, his injury a little suspect that maybe he was running that old playbook and then he opened it up again. I know there's talk about rolling him out right, rolling him out left, and only having to deal with half the field at a time. But I don't know that that's the best way to do something when you're developing a quarterback. Don't you really want him to see the whole field and not just half at a time?
You want him to go through all of his progressions, all of his reads, his first choice, his second, and his third choice. All the good quarterbacks do it. That are successful. So I don't think you take them out of that. I think I agree with you. You know, you got to develop them.
Trubisky did look like after the first four series of the Packer game is that he was back to his 1-2 drop instead of the 1-2-3-4, and he was making decisions a lot quicker. He seems to do that when he rolls out, but he doesn't seem to do that when he's in the pocket. He waits too long in the pocket.
Yeah.
I could be wrong. This is just something I saw.
Well, I think they may have reduced his reads early on. Like you said, they may have dumbed down the playbook. And, you know, get the ball out quickly. Look at your first two reads. If they're not there, then, you know, get down or run the football, you know. So I'm sure they simplified it when they saw he was struggling. I mean, most good coaches will do that to try to help the player, you know, get out of a funk.
But was he struggling because of himself, or was he struggling because
they
of Nagy
him.
Going back into the old playbook for the first four series?
Well, you heard a lot of people saying that.
I'm going to answer that. I think he was confused by what the coach was doing. I think there was a lack of communication where they were not in sync like a coach and quarterback have to be. Now, the two games prior to the Packers game, yes, it looked like last year. Yes, it looked like the confidence was back. Then you go into the Packers game, and it's like, are we going to keep doing what we were doing, or are we going to get too cute? And in the NFL, the coaches often get too cute, you know, passing every time when it's first and goal inside the five. I mean, you know, that's the problem. Too much thinking, too much cuteness, just when you thought they'd turn the corner. And really, the Packer game was a huge step backwards.
Mm-hmm. And you really don't like to see what we saw, man. I'll be honest. Hey, kudos to the Packers and all the Packer fans and Lake County and everything else. They're happy they made it to the playoffs, you know, with that win as well. By the way, the Bears didn't get knocked out because of the Packers. That's part of it. But Minnesota, by winning their game out in L.A. against the Chargers, that's what pushed the Bears out of the playoffs. You know, there's one other game I want to bring up that gets me, that really hurts me. You mentioned the Raiders game, Steve. But the Rams game, they had that game in the bag. There's another game that they let go. And there's been a series of games this year. They could have turned the record around three or four games in their direction if they knew how to play an entire game, then play these quarter, maybe a quarter or a half, and look like a team.
I think the Ram game was one of those that was a little bit different. And when I say that, as I could tell this schematically, that the Rams had prepared, caught the Bears off guard. They quick-snapped them. They bootlegged opposite ways, so they took away their pass rush. So there was no pass rush. They got no pressure on Goff. And on those bootlegs, he was able to throw the ball downfield. And once he got that going, you're able to run off the bootleg because you're so effective throwing the ball downfield. So to me, that was more of a strategy, a game plan that the Rams just beat the Bears on. They had no answer for it. You could see it in the game.
And it really comes down to the same old axiom. Your record is who you are, and you're 7-7. Now, for me, I think I think the bar is still rising. I think the Bears will be a much better team next year. They'll probably have less injuries. Trubisky will be a little bit older, and I think at this point they're probably going to keep him because it's probably a no-risk deal with that fifth-year option. Nothing wrong with doing that, but they do have to address some sort of a decent backup in the offseason. They have to do it. They have no choice, whether that's drafting somebody in the third or fourth round or bringing somebody in. But obviously Daniels is not going to be the answer to that.
Yeah, their offensive line needs work. To me, that's an area that I would look at. And then also, I would look for an extremely fast receiver. I still don't see our Bears receivers separating in key situations.
They don't get separation. You're exactly right. They don't get separation. We also need a tight end.
Yeah. Allen Robinson's the only receiver we can count on.
You need a couple receivers somewhere that are going to catch the ball. Whether you go out to free agency, get a veteran or two. This is something that's lacking with the Bears for a number of years. They can get a running back, get a quarterback, but then they don't get receivers. Then you get receivers, then you don't have a quarterback or a running back. Get the pieces together. Get yourself organized as a team. And that's the thing that, tell you the truth, if you look at the Bears and look at the Packers, Packers, for some reason, are a better organization because they get the pieces they need to get winners, to be a winner. I mean, Rodgers is going to throw the football. You need receivers. They always seem to find receivers. There's not many good receivers up there in Green Bay, but they're getting the job done and they're winning games.
Well, the thing is that Rodgers puts the demand on there. We were having this conversation a year ago, and we were talking about his relationship with the coach who he de facto got rid of, and they brought in a new coach, and there was a lot of arguments about play calling and et cetera. But, you know, there was a fight there, and he got receivers. He got different people in there. And also, he was able to control the play calls a little bit more.
Another interesting fact I think we probably overlook here, and that is one of the biggest improvements of the Bears this year is kick return. Last year, they were 30th of the league. This year, they're third, and their punt return is still two after being one last year. That's been a huge, huge improvement.
Well, they did. Cordarrelle Patterson is largely responsible for
that.
Yes,
he
is. Great special teams player. He's a great wild card type player that if you know how to put him in there, he's very explosive and athletic. And you saw the plays that he made. I mean, he's money in the bank.
You know, I don't know what they're going to do about this field goal kicking situation. We're 31st in the league beyond 40 yards, and you just can't be 31st in the league beyond 40 yards.
Not if you're going to win divisional championships or Super Bowls.
I think they got to go back and get Cody Parkey. Come on. Let's make that happen. I think that's the best way to go on that.
Come on.
But what are the odds that he's going to hit another upright?
That's right.
Yeah, pretty small.
Yeah.
Well, he's pretty good at it.
Hey, guys, let's go through our picks here. I've got a couple of decent games here. I got a couple of games that we have to pick from. Of course, Bruce has got his note sheet. I got to give him credit. He's got his notepad with him.
I've already set to
good.
Go here.
Let's start out with the Bears playing tomorrow night on the lakefront, Soldier Field, on a beautiful, balmy December night. 40 degrees will be at kickoff. They could have flexed this game out, but they think Kansas City is a good draw. Mahomes is going to be having an outstanding night coming up. I just don't see that. The Bears are hurt on defense mentally, physically, and this is going to be a scary game. I'll start out with you, Don. What do you think? What will the Bears do against Mahomes and the Chiefs tomorrow night?
Well, I don't think they got anybody that can match up with Tyreek Hill, so that's going to be a problem. And then you've got the most prolific passer in the game throwing downfield. Their defensive secondary, as you talked about the numbers, not so well rated this year. They're not getting the turnovers that they did a year ago, and they're not getting the pass rush. More importantly, the pass rush is linked to how well the secondary does. If you're not getting pressure on the quarterback, then they have to cover longer. People don't understand that relationship sometimes, and that's what you're seeing with the Bears' defense. That's where the breakdown is.
Yep.
So you're taking who tomorrow night?
Kansas City.
Kansas City. I'm going with you. I truly believe, and I said this earlier this week on one of the other shows, I threw it out to Norm and Patrick on the Golden Voice. I said, Bears will win this game big, and I mean big. Or not the Bears. I mean Kansas City will win this game big. 38-6. That much. Bruce?
I fear the quarterback controversy will begin or continue as Kansas City cleans up on the Bears.
Yeah. You know what? You almost have to say that. It's inevitable.
Mm-hmm. Steve?
I'm scared to death 38-6 might be the halftime score. I mean, the Chiefs have been a disappointment in some ways this year. They are waking up, and the seeding in the AFC playoffs is wide open. The Chiefs have a lot to play for. I think they'll be all business, and they will steamroll the Bears.
All right.
There's that the consensus bothers me. Yeah. Everybody agrees.
Yeah,
not everybody could be right at the same time.
Yeah, I know that, but no one's being a homer on this one. That's the interesting thing. Next game on the list is a place where the Packers have problems when they go to Minnesota and take on the Vikings. If it's in Green Bay, I feel very confident about this. But the Vikings are playing good football at the right time of the year in the final weeks of the regular season. And, Bruce, I'm looking at you, and you get first choice on this game. Good luck.
Yeah, I'd take a Minnesota in this game.
You didn't even hesitate on that.
Not a hesitation at all. I think they're not going to steamroll Packers, mm-hmm. but it's going to be a decisive win, I think.
Mm-hmm. Steve?
I think the Vikings, I think the Packers will give them a game, and maybe Rodgers will push at the end and come up a bit short. But this is a very important game for the NFC playoff picture. Both teams have a lot to play for. This might be the best game of the weekend. It'll be fun to watch.
Mm-hmm. Don?
Yeah, I'm going with the Packers because I think Aaron Rodgers is a clutch player. And I think when you measure him up against the guy on the other side, as good as his defense is, because they're giving him the football a lot, and as good a year as he's having, Aaron Rodgers is a clutch player. And I go with that. I think that's where my money's going. Because he has a way of inspiring his team. Davante Adams, Aaron Jones, if he's healthy and playing well, he's a tough matchup.
Mm-hmm. I'll tell you the truth. I'm a little bit concerned about this game because it's indoors. It's one of those places that Rodgers has a tough time going to. In Minnesota, has a tough time. And I know, believe it or not, Minnesota's playing very well. And Green Bay's got a great shot to put a dent into what's going on with these teams like Seattle and San Francisco and New Orleans by getting in the mix with a win here. So it means a lot, but I have to go with the Vikings in this one. I can't steer myself away with the fact, Rodgers is one of the best quarterbacks in football. There's no doubt about that. He can carry the team to a victory, but I'm going home cooking. I'm going to go with the Vikings. Tough choice, but I'm going there. Next game, I think it's tough. By the way, I dropped any game with Detroit at this point. They just haven't shown me anything. So we got two games that are part of the best games of the week. So Rams on the road in San Francisco. The Rams have turned the corner. They've been awfully tough the last few weeks. San Francisco has had a rough schedule the last few. They've had some tough games going on. And I guess I'll have to make the choice first here. Some people say I don't pick it first, but I will have to do this. And this is a tough one to pick from because the Rams didn't show me much last week as I thought they would. All of us, we thought that they were going to go into Dallas and do something. Will they falter again or will they wake up? That's the question mark in a game like this. And this is a tough choice. I mean, Frisco, didn't they come away with a nice win against New Orleans last week? Or was that 2 weeks ago? I'm thinking of they did. I think it was 2 weeks ago they had that big win over New Orleans. So they're riding on something here. Tough choice, but I'm going to go with San Francisco at home. It's tough. I have to lean that way at this point. Don?
I'm going with San Francisco only because statistically the Rams have given up 31.7 points per game in the last three games. Their defensive line is kind of banged up. That's not good because that means pass rush. You're going up against a Niners team that is complete, and they're getting Richard Sherman back, their team leader, on defense. So I see the Niners being a solid win against the Rams.
All right, Steve?
What the Rams did last week against the Cowboys, which was what I thought they would do the week before against Seattle, just lay an absolute egg. I just had the wrong week for the egg they laid. I'm sick of the Rams. I mean, one day they look like they're getting their act together, then they fall flat on their face.
Sybil.
The 49ers are a much better team. Can we just end this? Put us out of our misery. Let's let the 49ers win about 35-3, please.
Wow. Bruce?
Well, Steve, here's our chance for the Rams to lay an ostrich egg in this game rather than just a chicken egg. I think San Francisco rolls big.
You think San Francisco's going to roll big, huh? All right, I'll put you down for San Francisco.
You got to love that tight end, George Kittle, for the Niners. Very impressive young man.
All right, the last game on the list, believe it or not, like I said, we dropped Detroit, so we got an extra game to pick from with the good games. And I went down this list, And I came up, I thought, with a game that I have no clue which way it's going to go for the meaningless NFC East.
I'm looking at this.
Dallas against Philadelphia. You thought I was going somewhere else.
No, it's exactly the game I'm looking
at. Oh,
you
really? Okay.
Yeah.
I'm glad you're looking at it because you're going first, buddy.
Do I have to?
Yes. I put you on the spot on this one.
This is a squeaky one.
No. What do you think?
I think the Cowboys are good enough for this game.
You think they're good enough after what they really showed last week? They're on the road.
I think they're good enough this game. They'll snap back.
So, okay, you're going to go with Dallas. Don?
Yeah, I'm going with Dallas because Dallas has the talent in all positions to do it. They just have to get on the same page mentally. I think guys like Jason Witten will try to galvanize some of these young players, Randall Cobb, guys that have won before, Michael Bennett, and they'll kind of, lay down the law, get these guys together. Dak Prescott played much better last week, so I think, if he and Amari Cooper are going and Zeke's going, it's a tough offensive stop.
I'll tell you one thing about this. Okay, Dallas woke up last week. Big win. They needed it. All the controversy has been flying around Dallas and everything. We've talked about it here on this show the last few weeks. And I just can't buy into it that Dallas has woken up enough. And Philadelphia playing at home, they seem to play better there. There's really a division title on the line, a chance to get to the playoffs here for the Eagles. And the Eagles have this aura. They have this way of getting there. And I think this is going to be the time they're going to wake up and do it. I think that I have to go with the Eagles at home. I can't go against that.
Steve? Yeah, I think they're going to be, homer.
Mm-hmm. It could cost you the lead.
Let me tell you guys, the Cowboys are like the Rams, up and down. So this is the weekend for the Cowboys to be down. They're going to get a little too high after what they did to the Rams. We've got some great playoff games coming up in the NFC, and it would be greater if we could disqualify this entire division. But Philly, by default, I've got Philly winning this game.
Mm-hmm. It's funny, too, because wherever Mike McCarthy is, he's following my league because he's going Philly as well. And some of the other picks, too. He went Kansas City, and he joined most of the consensus picks.
I have a chance to take a big move here.
You think so?
With Dallas?
Mm. Yeah, I know you're a game behind me. I know you are. Any last thoughts, Steve?
I just want to say Merry Christmas. Get out there and attend a holiday basketball tournament. I'll be covering games at the Marseilles tournament along I-80 just west of Seneca. Can't wait to get there. My old friends, Spring Valley Hall from years ago, they're the defending champions. So, hey, get to a basketball tournament. Enjoy the holidays, everybody.
Steve, can you do me a favor? Can you sign autographs when you're out there?
Hey, I just might. Some of those Spring Valley guys might remember me from years and years ago. I'm an older man now. I got a little gray, but I still like the red.
Okay.
Merry Christmas, Steve.
Hey, happy holidays, Steve. Enjoy it.
Take care, guys.
Bye-bye. All right. Steve Brandy joining with us. And I'll tell you one thing. It is the holiday season. And I know everyone talks about Christmas, but there's another song that comes up in my mind around this time of year because it's kind of strange that this falls, believe it or not, right around the same time as Hanukkah this year.
Yeah, it does. Hanukkah's late this year.
And I got my buddy to help me out, because I always bring this out right around Hanukkah.
Happy Chanukkah.
Remember Adam Sandler?
Sandler, yeah. I knew you were going there.
Take a break, back with more. Happy Hanukkah, too. Kevin the Swamp Rat coming up next on the Sports Corner.
Guess my first two songs didn't do it for ya. So here comes number three. Ross and Phoebe from Friends say the Hanukkah blessing. So does Lenny's pal Squiggy and Will and Grace's Deborah Messing. Melissa Gilbert and Michael Landon never mix meat with dairy. Maybe they should have called that show Little Kosher House on the Prairie. We got Jerry and Lewis, Ben Stiller and Jack Black. Tom Arnold converted to Judaism, but you guys can have him back. Justin. We may not get to kiss underneath the mistletoe, but we can do it all night long with Deuce Bigelow.
You're listening to 98.3 FM, WRLR LP, Round Lake, Illinois.
Today's sports broadcast is made possible by O'Keefe Lewis and Bruno PC, proud to sponsor another season of Lake County High School sports broadcasts on WRLR 98.3 FM, helping home buyers, sellers, and others with real estate transactions. O'Keefe Lewis and Bruno PC can be reached at 847-675-4790.
What's it like to walk in the shoes of a Navy SEAL, a beekeeper, a rabbi, a dentist, a ghost hunter, or a professional clown? Join me, Jim Wunderlich, on Word of Mouth, Thursday mornings from 11 a.m. to noon, and hear their stories. Captivating guests from a wide range of professions sharing a behind-the-curtain view of their jobs. Jobs such as an interrogator from Guantanamo, a private chef, a film director, a doctor, an orchestra conductor, a college basketball coach.
WRLR sports programming is made possible in part through the support of Jersey Mike's in Round Lake Beach. Jersey Mike serves authentic Northeastern-style sub sandwiches that are fresh sliced and fresh grilled. Their menu offers items for students and teachers like the Giant Sub. Complete menu details available now at jerseymikes.com. If your sports team or organization is looking to raise funds, Jersey Mike's in Round Lake Beach can tell you how. They're located at 536 East Rollins Road, and their number is 224-757-5391.
When I'm under, I'm weightless, floating away, and all I think about is doing it again.
Michael Swan is under the influence of his volunteer swim coach. Spending a little time coaching, he helps Michael stay off drugs. Be a coach, a mentor, a volunteer. No matter what it is, you have something to offer. Log on to helpyourcommunity.org or call 877-KIDS-313 and be an influence on the kids in your community. Brought to you by the Office of National Drug Control Policy and the Ad Council.
WRLR 98.3 FM.
Welcome back to the Sports Corner, Sports Guys for Saturday morning. Just a few days away from Christmas, Hanukkah. That's only a couple days away. But I want to wish everybody a happy holidays as we're enjoying this final Saturday right before the big days that are coming up. 30 degrees outside, sunshine out there. Should be mostly sunny today, much warmer. We're going to push that temperature up to, believe it or not, I'm going to go all the way up to 47 today, is what I'm saying. Bruce is saying no way. The reason why I say that, because I think the winds are going to be lighter, and I think we're going to push a little bit of the warmth. However, this is what gets me, and I got to throw Bruce in here quickly, because I know he's our weather guy, does a hot weather hour, and I know he follows weather, we talk about it and everything. Just briefly here, the question is, there's been talk of a couple sources, maybe we could hit 60 degrees by Christmas. Now, you're shaking your head. There's a possible lake breeze that comes into effect.
Backdoor cold front.
Also, I'm wondering, with the snow that happened last week south of us, and the south winds.
Should be almost gone by now.
Should be almost gone. It's not going to affect us in any
way. Probably not. It's disappeared from the global ensemble.
Has it disappeared? Yeah. Okay, so it's melted off. But the thing is, would the lake effect take too much in account here?
It could. I mean, there could be a backdoor cold front.
And then curl those temperatures down. Now, I remember I sent you a note on this. I was talking with somebody last night when we were out at the basketball game at Warren. I remember back in 1982, it was 65 degrees on that day during the day, and then by late afternoon, it dropped to 38. But that's the warmest Christmas on record.
Yeah, I put out the forecast, as a matter of fact, this morning, as we do every morning on our Facebook page. And it takes me about an hour and a half to do it every morning, and I don't always remember exactly what I put on it on each day. But I believe that I went with, there we go.
You don't even remember what you did.
No, it's I think it
went around 50.
Together. Let's see. I have variable clouds on Christmas Day in 43.
43. I think we're going to touch 50.
I think we're
going to
get that backdoor cold front. It's questionable yet, but we'll find out.
Tell you the truth, I think we're going for 50.
I'll take 43 on Christmas Day.
And it's amazing because golf courses are opening up this week.
So bad to play on a golf course at this time of year. Well, it really ruins them.
It may say it rules them, but the grounds have been pretty
pretty dry. We haven't had much precipitation.
No.
However, there's been some frost lately, which the ground is pretty hard. You get a great bounce out there, I'll say that, off the grounds. But what gets me is if it warms up enough, the ground's going to get a little soft out there.
Yeah, that's what tears up the course.
Mm. So I'm not 100% sold on the idea. I've got an idea that I might want to sneak out myself, get the clubs out if I get an opportunity around work.
I usually pass on golf, anything under 60.
Yeah, but you know, to get out in December with that feel like, hey, I played golf in December in 2019.
Now, you know,
it's pretty cool.
I can sympathize with that because last year it was so cold in March, I got out and put the skates on and skated outdoors in March. And I just so I could do it.
Uh-huh.
Well, so I could sympathize with, you know, wanting to play golf in December and say, you know, I played golf at Christmas time.
Yeah.
In 2019.
Why not?
But that's the novelty of it. You want to say, hey, you know, I did it. I played golf in December before.
Get your horns.
I played golf in January before.
Yeah.
It's a rarity. It doesn't happen that often.
Oh, Rusty, I had a friend of mine who, you talk about a golf fanatic, he would get out there at 10 above zero and get out on the course. You know, the lakes are frozen. So he didn't care. He just wanted to hit the ball. Frozen ground at all. He was crazy.
That's like taking on those chilly opens where you play on lakes and they scrape it off where it's really cold and you're able to be on the lake and, you know, hitting golf balls with strings and trying to find it in the snow. But the best part
is that so you can call it back if you have a bad shot?
But the best part of that is when you get done, they've got some outstanding chili waiting for you in hot coffee or hot chocolate.
I just made chili last night, as a matter of fact.
Uh-huh.
I mean, it'll have to last me for about a month.
So, I mean, you might be able to play on ground. I mean, we're not looking for any snow here for through the end of the year at this point.
Probably not. I mean, it's the pattern looks to maybe change a little bit as we get into the new year, but hey, nothing barbaric or anything, but it's falling right into what I said was going to happen. It's going to come up mid-January, then bang.
Well, we've seen that before. No snow in December, and the next, you know, the first couple of days of January, you get hit with a big snowstorm. I remember seeing that a couple times.
I keep forgetting I'm sandwiched in between two weather aficionados.
You got weather geeks in front of you.
Yeah.
And we got another guy who's on the phone who knows more than that because we're talking about bulls, and that's Kevin the Swamp Rat. Good morning, Kevin. How you doing?
Oh, listen, I love hearing the Hanukkah song.
You love that, huh? Hey,
what's up, Kevin?
Hey, Kevin, there's somebody who's celebrating. Hey, Kevin, there's a lot of celebration going on down in Texas, and we better jump on this quickly because we got a team, North Central College, that played down in the Stag Bowl against Wisconsin Whitewater. I was actually watching this when I got home last night. They had a pretty decent crowd down there, but how often do we get a team from Illinois, number one, that can play in a bowl game, and number two, win one the way they did? Because they won 41-14 over Wisconsin Whitewater. And by the way, I want to throw this out. The player of the game, the MVP,
from the Lakes,
comes from Lakes High School, Ethan Greenfield. How about that?
Yeah, their top running back.
How about that, Kevin?
And it was great that they, you know, this wasn't a slight victory. I mean, they took them to the woodshed.
That was over early.
That was very convincing, 41-14. And to show you how significant this is, now, during the Buffalo-Charlotte Bahama Bowl game, you know, Whitewater's former coach, Lance Leopold, he's coaching Buffalo now.
Uh-huh.
This is how good this program is. They're 51-9 overall in playoff games.
Wow.
And during Leopold's time at Whitewater, he compiled a record of 109 wins and only 6 losses.
Uh-huh.
So this is significant. This was a huge win for North Central. Congratulations to the Cardinals.
Yeah, by the way, one other player, too, that came from Lakes, D'Lo Hardy's also on that team for North Central. So this is no slouch. I mean, they've been beating opponents in the playoffs by 30 points the last few weeks. I've been keeping an eye on this. So congratulations off to North Central getting their first ever championship.
Greenfield stats, 138 yards, 3 touchdowns, and he's only a sophomore out of the Lakes. Lindenhurst, give some Lindenhurst love. And it's nice to see local guys do well. And he led the team in rushing with well over 700 yards this season. So, congratulations to Mr. Greenfield on an outstanding effort and bringing home the bacon.
And the trophy.
I was thinking last night that maybe we should stop doing Division One and cover Division Three.
That could be more exciting. We got more local there. And by the way, we got to throw out kudos to Illinois State. They made it to the semifinals last week, I heard, against a very powerful North Dakota State on the road.
Yeah, and believe me, North Dakota State, they are good. they could beat, in fact, they have beaten some Division I-A teams. So.
Yeah, we've got a kid from Libertyville at North Dakota State there. He's a defensive end. So we've got a lot of, you know, we're seeing a lot of local tie-ins to these teams.
Mm-hmm.
Because, well, we had National Signing Day this week, and I was going through the list, and that conference, that North Central is there. They signed a lot of Lake County players.
Mm-hmm. You got some names to throw us? Because I can throw a few names, too. But you got any big names you want to throw at me about signing day?
I mean, there's a lot of them, The ones I'm looking at is like Jack Ruskell from Libertyville.
Uh-huh.
He's actually going to walk on to Alabama. But Ryan O'Malley from Libertyville,
mm-hmm.
Hooked on with Army. You got Charlie Jones. There's a football name. Charlie Jones from Deerfield.
Uh-huh.
He signed on with the Buffalo Bulls.
Uh-huh.
Let's see. We got.
I can just
kind of scrolling down because there were just so many of them.
Yeah, I know. I can throw a couple. You got Hunter Welsing from Lake Zurich. He's going to Northwestern, wide receiver, tight end there. And then also, what about Mr. Watson or Moses? I should say Jack Moses. Jack Moses. He's going to be a preferred walk-on and a quarterback for Northwestern too.
Henry Marchese is his name. I think from Stevenson.
Yep, the receiver.
He signed on with Iowa.
Mm-hmm.
Miami of Ohio, they raided Lake County. With the two big ones being Joshua Mays from Deerfield, signing out with the Redhawks, and Jacob Schwartz from Highland Park.
Yeah, uh-huh. Congratulations to the kids out of Stevenson. Jordan Vincent for the Stevenson Patriots signed a letter of intent for Eastern Illinois, and I think Miles Williams, their defensive tackle, signed with Butler. So those are two local guys. Uh-huh.
And let's not forget, Willis Singleton, our player of the year, is headed off to Iowa State. Yeah, so.
Who was in the playoff today.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
That's it.
Cameron Ruiz, also from Lakeshore, signed with Northwestern.
Uh-huh.
Oh, yeah, he's there. Cameron's there.
Yeah, he's there already, yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, it's amazing, all these great players, and it goes to show, and I've been saying this to you, Kevin, and a lot of people don't realize the competition value and the type of players that we have in Lake County. I'll throw another one that hit my mind, too. Trey Watson, who initially we had thought Minnesota has decided to go to Illinois State.
Yeah. Trey, got injured, but we know what a terrific defensive player he was and turned out to be a pretty fine offensive player as well. So, I mean, Illinois State, we talked about that. So but I think he's going to do well.
Mm-hmm.
And it's funny how, with the Division I schools, usually Illinois gets a lot of Illinois players, not just Lake County, but Illinois players. And Northern Illinois kind of gets whatever Illinois didn't pick, and Northwestern usually goes national. This year it was totally the opposite. Illinois, they signed 12 players, none from Illinois.
Hmm.
Northwestern, 17. And they had... Let's see, they had three or four from Illinois, and Northern Illinois had 27 players signed, only two from Illinois.
Fitz is calling this his best signing class ever for Northwestern. That's what he said, so that's pretty impressive.
Yeah.
And there's some other guys.
They went heavy on defense, too, because four of them were from on the defensive line, and four of the cornerbacks were safeties. So they went heavy on the defense side of the ball. Illinois, almost half of their signees were defensive linemen. and offensive, they also tried to build up the offensive line too. Which you know how they say in baseball, you build a team up the middle: catcher, mm-hmm. pitcher, shortstop, second base, and center fielder. I've always felt that if you're trying to start over, start with either line and take it from there.
Well, we saw the Niners do that on the pro level. They drafted all linemen for the last three or four drafts. Yeah. Defensive lineman, I should say.
Exactly, exactly. And Northern Illinois, they went heavy on defense, too. Of the 27, five of them were defensive linemen, eight defensive backfield players. So, yeah, they went heavy on the defensive end of it, too. So, actually, oh, yeah, we forgot Wisconsin and Notre Dame. Wisconsin, they signed 24 players and seven linebackers they signed.
A lot of them from the north suburbs, you know.
Yes.
The last couple of years.
And six offensive linemen, and Notre Dame signed 13, of which, again, they went heavy on defense, too. Four defensive linemen.
Along with
the defensive backfield.
Along with Riley Mills from Lake Forest, which Joe Aguilar and John Kerr were talking about on their show on Thursday. He's highly recruited out of Lake Forest, and he's big, he's huge, and he's talented, and he's going to do something out there for the Irish. I can see that happening the next couple of years.
And
of course, Rich got richer. Clemson was the number one overall. Alabama was second. Ohio State third.
Oh, boy. So, sounds like the teams we all know about, don't we?
And I want to give...
I know, you know, D, what a surprise that was.
Uh-huh. We should recognize the guys that are going to the ICA Shrine Bowl. We got a couple of guys on that list. Matt Rich, offensive lineman for Warren, and Jaden Lowry. And then Braden Yokohama out of Stevenson, the linebacker. Kai Williams, the tight end from Lake Forest. And Kai Kroger, the great kicker at Lake Forest. We saw him in that last game. Those guys are going to the ICA Shrine Bowl game in June. So congratulations.
All right. Kevin, let's talk about the Bulls. There's a bunch of them going on today. You mentioned yesterday that was pretty easy for Buffalo in Bahamas. Well, of course, it looked pretty nice out there. What do we have, like a half dozen bowl games today? Is that right?
Half dozen is exactly the number. It starts at 1 o'clock with the New Mexico Bowl, Central Michigan, and San Diego State. By the way, the Mac, they won two games yesterday. I think they only won one the entire bowl season last year.
Oh.
So they're off to a good start. And it was good to see Buffalo and Kent State. This was their first. Kent State, I can't believe this. This was their first bowl win ever.
Really?
Ever.
Huh.
And I mean, they had some great players go through that program. And Buffalo was their first as well. But the Central Michigan, San Diego State, that's the first one. You've got the Cure Bowl. The Cure Bowl.
Oh, okay. That's what I thought you said.
Georgia Southern and Liberty. You've got probably one of the better ones overall, not just today, but Florida Atlantic against SMU. SMU had a renaissance season this year. Both teams won 10 games, and although Florida Atlantic lost their coach, who's coaching Mississippi, I believe, kicked one. And also, they've got some suspended players going into this game, too. So it looked like it was going to be a Florida Atlantic win. Now it looks like it's going to shift, and maybe SMU is going to win this game, although it is on Florida Atlantic's home field. So, but that's coming up today. Florida International with Arkansas State. In the Chameleon Bowl, I think it's called, the Las Vegas Bowl. This is going to be the best one of the day, I think. Washington and Boise State, they're calling it the Chris Peterson Bowl. Chris Peterson used to coach Boise State. He now is coaching Washington, and he's actually retired. He's stepping down for anxiety reasons.
Hmm. That's different.
That's a good reason.
Uh-huh. Hey, Steve, I got a question for you about that game.
And then Appalachian State and UAB, and then the other one.
Yeah, that's going to be a good one. App State.
It is. Appalachian State is proven. They're the goods.
Uh-huh.
I have a question about that game. That's my appointment television this evening is Washington and Boise State. Why is number 19 Boise State actually a dog in this game?
That's a good question.
That is a great question. Yeah, they're pretty good.
And I wish I had a good answer for you.
Yeah, that doesn't make sense.
It doesn't make sense to me at all.
Yeah, they appear to be healthy. Washington, let's face it, if Washington was any good, they'd be in a higher
level. Well, yeah, I mean, they beat Washington State. Okay, big deal. Anthony Gordon is, he's good, but, apparently not that good. So,
and we can't forget the Celebration Bowl, Alcorn State North Carolina.
Oh, wow.
A&T.
Oh,
that's right. Yeah. That's
yeah.
Right. At the Mercy. Alcorn. What is it? Alcorn State and North Carolina A&T, right?
Yeah, that's right. A&T is obviously Tariq Cohn's school, our current Bear player. And Alcorn State also produced Leslie Frazier.
Leslie Frazier. Uh-huh.
Defensive
yeah.
back. Great cornerback. A lot of other kids, too. But
a lot of great players in the past have come from the SWAC.
Yep.
I.e. Walter Payton.
Yeah. Uh-huh. Yeah. A lot of
from Jackson State.
Hey, Kevin, I know there's so many bowls this week, and the fact that they're starting so late here this year, it's kind of interesting. They're all compact in here with the 41 games and the playoffs. Any other games that we need to kind of watch as we roll through Christmas and into next week, into Friday?
Well, the ones I'm paying attention to are the ones who are either Big Ten or MAC teams are participating. A couple of good ones I think is going to be Eastern Michigan, Pittsburgh, in the Quick Lane Bowl. They got all these different bowl games.
Of course.
Of course I can't read my own writing. well, one interesting one is going to be Christmas Eve, BYU in Hawaii.
Huh. Ooh. Yeah, that could
not
be interesting.
Defense, I suspect, is going to be played in this game.
As you've said once before, the defense rests. Sounds like court.
Yes,
that's in Hawaii, too, isn't it? That's at Aloha Stadium, I would think, right? BYU at Hawaii's got to be at Aloha Stadium, I would think of, which I was at. Yeah. I visited that in the summertime, so I do know where it's at officially now. But that should be a fun game.
Notre Dame and Iowa State.
Notre Dame, Iowa State.
The Camping World Bowl.
It's going to be interesting to see how Notre Dame comes out in this game because, you know, this bowl game is kind of really beneath them a little bit. Uh-huh. And it'll be interesting, just like Michigan and Alabama, they're meeting each other. I think that's not until next. Mm-hmm. That's the Citrus Bowl.
Don't sleep on Iowa State.
Alabama has gone through all these years going in since the start of the playoffs. They've been in the semifinals, in the finals.
Uh-huh.
This is going to be interesting to see what kind of mental makeup they come out in, and Michigan for that matter. It's a great matchup, but you just don't know what the mental makeup of the two teams are going to be. But
hey, Kevin, we only got a couple minutes left here. I wanted to briefly talk about college basketball because DePaul still hasn't made the top 25. They deserve to be there right now. But they are going to take on Northwestern, I heard, this weekend. Some Legends tournament?
Today.
Uh-huh.
They're playing them today at Wintrust Arena. And I saw Northwestern against Michigan State.
What'd you think?
First of all, Northwestern's the youngest team in the Big Ten, okay? So, but I'm telling you, I like what I saw. Even though they lost five, I like what I saw from Northwestern. And this is not going to be an easy game for DePaul. For both teams, their final non-conference game, and I don't know why they're not ranked either, Rusty, because especially when I saw Michigan State with a 7-3 record was ranked, and I almost hit the floor when I saw Texas Tech being ranked, and the ball beat them. But here's one thing I think this is put in proper perspective. Because a lot of these big teams don't play real road games, okay? Neutral site games are about as good as it gets for, like, Duke and Kansas and Kentucky. And Minnesota and Iowa both have home records of 5-1.
Uh-huh.
Both teams, the one loss was to DePaul.
Hmm. Interesting.
So, you know.
So they're the Rodney Dangerfield of basketball right now. I don't get no respect.
No question.
I tell you.
Also in college basketball tonight, the Border War, Illinois and Missouri going at it tonight. And a lot of the schools will be taking the rest of the week off and starting the following week. Conference play starts in earnest next week.
Mm-hmm. What's our record, by the way, for state schools?
For basketball, it's overall 74-71, and 1-3 in conference.
So we're hanging there. All right, Kevin, any last thoughts? Yeah. We got to let you go. Any last thoughts?
No, listen, Merry Christmas to all the listeners and to you boys in the studio, and enjoy yourselves. Hope you don't get cold.
All right. Thanks a lot, Kevin. We appreciate
Kevin, have a
enjoy
good one.
The games.
Enjoy the games. There's a lot of them.
All right. Take care and happy holidays, buddy.
You too.
All right. We got to hit the break. We'll come back. We got a coach to talk to, believe it or not. The new head coach from Carmel to join with us. We'll talk about basketball, too. The game we had on last night, which Norm took part with me over at Warren High School, Lake Forest and Warren. We'll talk about the holiday tournaments. Stay with us. More to come. Sports Corner Sports Guys for Saturday morning. Feliz Navidad. Feliz Navidad.
Feliz Navidad. Romero, neutral site games are about as good as it gets for, like, Duke and Kansas and Kentucky. And Minnesota and Iowa both have home records of 5-1.
Uh-huh.
Both teams, the one loss was to DePaul.
Hmm. Interesting.
So
they're the Rodney Dangerfield of basketball right now. I don't get no respect.
No question.
I tell you.
Also in college basketball tonight, the border war, Illinois and Missouri going at it tonight. And a lot of the schools will be taking the rest of the week off and starting finally, conference play starts in earnest next week.
Mm-hmm. What's our record, by the way, for state schools?
For basketball, it's overall 74-71, and 1-3 in conference.
So we're hanging there. All right, Kevin, any last thoughts? Yeah. We got to let you go. Any last thoughts?
No, listen, Merry Christmas to all the listeners and to you boys in the studio, and enjoy yourselves. Hope you don't get cold.
All right. Thanks a lot, Kevin. We appreciate
it. Kevin, have a
good
one.
The games.
Enjoy the games. There's a lot of them.
All right. Take care and happy holidays, buddy.
You too.
All right. We got to hit the break. We'll come back. We got a coach to talk to, believe it or not. The new head coach from Carmel to join with us. We'll talk about basketball, too. The game we had on last night, which Norm took part with me over at Warren High School, Lake Forest and Warren. We'll talk about the holiday tournaments. Stay with us. More to come. Sports Corner Sports Guys for Saturday morning. Feliz Navidad. Feliz Navidad. Feliz Navidad. Romero, año y felicidad. I want to wish you a Merry Christmas. I want to wish you.
You're listening to 98.3 FM, WRLR LP, Round Lake, Illinois.
Having trouble moving the ball to finish your divorce or paternity matter? Child support or maintenance payments causing trouble with your salary cap? Sue Kamen is an experienced family law attorney who can coach you through mediation or fire a pass into the end zone at trial. To make an appointment in Antioch, Huntley, or Lake Zurich with Susan E. Kamen and Associates, their number is 847-847-7354.
I like doo-wop music. My friends like doo-wop music. But all that counts is you like doo-wop music. I know you do. Admit it, you really do. Mark Shanahan likes doo-wop too. He's got a doo-wopper of a music library and lots of doo-wop energy. He wants to share his doo-wop music with you. So set your finger snapping and tune that dial to Mark's doo-wop hour every Monday afternoon at 2, right here on 98.3 FM and WRLR and WRLR.FM online. Uh-huh. Doo-wop.
Cornicione's New York-style pizzeria in Antioch at Routes 83 and 173 is another proud sponsor of WRLR Sports. Cornicione's pizza dough is made from scratch using a family recipe that originated in Brooklyn, New York. Their dough is proofed at least 24 hours. Cornicione's menu includes pizzas, calzones, pasta, much more. They have dine-in, carry-out, and delivery. Their number is 224-308-1499.
Hi, I'm Carson Beck. Do you like your weekly dose of Lake County sports? I have a show for you. Tune in to Lake County Sports Scoop right here on 98.3 WRLR on Mondays from 4 to 5 p.m. where me and my co-host, Carmel Corsair's assistant boys basketball coach, Fidel Garcia, recap and preview all things Lake County sports.
Carnicione's New York Style Pizzeria in Antioch at Routes 83 and 173 is another proud sponsor of WRLR Sports. Carnicione's pizza dough is made from scratch using a family recipe that originated in Brooklyn, New York. Their dough is proofed at least 24 hours. Carnicione's menu includes pizzas, calzones, pasta, much more. They have dine-in, carry-out, and delivery. Their number is 224-308-1499.
You're listening to 98.3 FM, WRLR LP, Round Lake, Illinois.
Happy Christmas, Julie. So this is Christmas.
Welcome back to the Sports Corner. Sports guys, for a Saturday morning, the holidays definitely here. And I figure it's holiday music time, right, as well, with a few days left until Christmas here, or Hanukkah, wherever you're celebrating. By the way, 32 degrees outside. Expected high today, 47. We'll go down to about 32 tonight. And then tomorrow, right around the same area, at 45, 46, 47 degrees. Try to push that number up a few more degrees to 50. Over the next few days, I'm going to go that route. I know Bruce is looking at me like, don't go 60.
50 is reasonable for tomorrow.
Yeah, I figure you want to throw a wager at me or something like that.
Well,
I don't know. I
almost pulled my wallet out of my pocket here. But
I thought you might want to do that, you know. So
I almost did that with one of Don's picks, too. So.
Oh, God, I can see that happen. Just a couple Bruce minutes past the hour of 9 o'clock, we've got to catch up with a new football coach at Carmel High School. Former Chicago Bears player, for that matter. He was on the staff of Blake Gannon, and a new coach, just newly named over at Carmel High School, being Jason McKee. And we're trying to catch him here. It's funny, what position did he play?
Played fullback for the Bears. He also played his college ball at Temple.
Did he really?
Who's in a bowl game today playing North Carolina. Again, a military bowl, did we say?
Yeah, military bowl.
Yeah.
And, of course, I try to reach him, and I can't get him. I don't like that. But I do like the idea that, you know, having a new coach and the fact that they didn't wait long to do this is important for Carmel.
Yeah, he was on staff. Jason was on staff along with Johnny Knox and some other former Bear players that were there. I think what they were trying to do was revitalize that program, you know, in the absence of, you know, they've had some successful years, but now they're in a tough go of it. They haven't gotten the numbers in the program like they would like to, so the numbers are down. That is the number of kids in the entire program, not just on the varsity, but we're talking all levels. So when you see that, that's usually not a good sign for your program if your lower levels are struggling and getting the numbers out. So that's going to be one of his, I would imagine, one of his first initiatives is to maybe, you know, be able to use his Bear power, his local power, to get the athletes come out and focused. You know,
it's interesting, too, because I know Blake Annan had to leave because of personal reasons, but Carmel the last few years hasn't been the same. You've had change of coaches now, a couple of them, and it's not the same program to what it was. I mean, Andy Biddle, great coach. Did a great job there. Maybe it was time for a change, maybe for something new. That's a possibility. I mean, I could take anything away from how Carmel has been a great program underneath Andy for a lot of years. He did a great job.
He did.
But maybe a change was in order. It's a possibility. But when you get change, you got to rebuild. You got to kind of get the spark, the fire back into it, which is going to draw the players to go back to Carmel. Is that's what it leads to, I would think, for Carmel right now.
Well, I would kind of draw a parallel between them and Mount Carmel from that standpoint, because Mount Carmel got to the point where they had a legend that was coaching them.
Frank Lenti, yeah.
Frank Lenti, yes. And Frank Lenti was running a certain type of offense that was, you know, probably outdated, you know, from the standpoint that if you got behind, it'd be tough to catch up with a team that runs, most of the teams run spread now, so they can put up 30 or 40 points like that in the blink of an eye. If you're running, you know, the old option, is very difficult to catch up to a team once you get behind. And so you heard those kind of complaints coming, and what did they do? They brought in Jordan Lynch, one of his former players, who was an All-American and a Heisman Trophy candidate, at Northern Illinois, and Jordan, a former quarterback, thinks like a coach. Mm-hmm. And he came in, put him in the spread. His son, not his son, his brother played quarterback, took him downstate this year, and they had a tremendous year. But I'm saying that, there was the same call for a change. And taking nothing away from, obviously, legends of high school football, you know, Frank Lenti, and obviously what Andy Biddle was able to do. I have a ultimate respect for Andy and what he's able to accomplish. So now there's a new regime there, and we'll see what Jason McKee's able to do. He's got his work cut out for him, but I think he's up for the task. Coming out of Gulf Breeze, Florida. That's where he's from originally. High school football there, and then went on to Temple.
Yeah, I think that's where I was trying to catch him up. I think he is down in Florida right now, to be honest. But we'll see if we're still trying to hook up with him there. But I think it's a good move for this situation, for Carmel. I think he will help the program. I think you'll see Carmel start rising. I don't know if it's going to happen next year, but I would think in the next few years, you'll see a team that's going to start being one of the better teams in Lake County.
Well, one of the things they got going for them is this restructuring of the conferences right now. And so really they're playing like in a four-team conference. This was the first year of the CCL, ESCC kind of Catholic League combination where they combined those two conferences. They split everybody up. So in their conference was St. Vider, St. Patrick, Marion, and Carmel. Carmel finished with a 2-7 at the bottom of that conference. So there was a reshuffling of the deck. But I think that's going to give a new coach like Jason opportunity.
I want to talk a little bit about high school football. You know, they passed the proposal this past week. Proposal, I think, was 15 for this year. And what they did on this proposal was the fact getting it out of districts that they voted on last year. And we know how much we were against that. I know Joe and John talked about it on Thursday on their show, which we broadcast last night before, you know, the game and the basketball game that we did. The thing is, having this away from going districts, and believe me, none of us were fans of it. We've had coaches that weren't fans of it here in Lake County. Not that it would affect a lot of the schools within our area, but some of the schools would have to travel. And I don't think teams like Waukegan would be in favor of this because they'd have to play teams like Loyola or teams that are pretty big around the, you know, area of Lake and Cook County because they're so big of a school they are. But their program is not at the same levels of Loyola for that matter at all. There's no way. And I don't think Loyola would want to play Waukegan and beat them 80-0.
It wouldn't really serve them. And we were having this discussion before. What are the prime points on the table? They want to see this. People were calling for this district restructuring because they thought that more teams would get opportunities to get into the playoffs. That seems to be at the crux of the matter. More teams want playoff opportunities. But I, quite frankly, I like the system that we're in right now. I think it works pretty good. It's not perfect, and it never will be. But I think that the teams that are always strong are going to be there no matter what. They're going to adjust. I know you hear people sometimes complaining about the Catholic League Blue, and they're complaining about the teams out west in the Naperville. But those teams are perennially strong, and they always will be because of the what they put into their program. So I think, you know, going to the district, I was really, quite frankly, not one of those people that wanted to support that. Not that my vote mattered, but the point is that people were talking about travel. ADs were talking about travel and the expense of travel for those teams on the fringe like a North Chicago who can't afford to do that, and they've got to book these buses and then come back late on a long drive back home. So, you know, that it didn't really favor them in that sense. So I'm not sure who's really pushing the districts, but I know a lot of coaches and administrators aren't all that happy about it. And they really want the ADs to vote on this, not the principals, not people that are not directly connected to the scheduling of the football games.
I'm sorry, Bruce. Go ahead. I'll let you go ahead.
I think the thing you run into is when you make a big change like that is you really don't have an opportunity to really think about the unintended consequences. Now, there could be some advantage to it. I know a lot of times you see in college football where a team gets blown out because they're playing out of their element. But maybe it's just me, or isn't there a kind of an opportunity here for maybe the kids every once in a while, they want to go to a place like Loyola. They want to kind of match up against areas that are better than them to kind of see how they stack up rather than squeezing everything to mediocrity for your own area.
The only thing is, though...
You don't have to do it a lot, but once in a while.
It's a good idea with that. There's nothing wrong with it. But when you get a conference like, for example, North Chicago would have to play a Stillman Valley. Or Chicago Juarez from the city has to go out somewhere out western part of the state to match up, you know, with the enrollment.
We don't have to go that far.
But the thing is, that's what you're kind of looking at. You're looking at teams around the St. Louis area that are 4A and 5A schools who have to travel all the way up to Peoria or travel up to the south suburbs.
That's the district formula.
Yeah, that's the district formula.
That's my problem.
By keeping it where you're at now is fine. What the future holds and what they're going to do, they said there's going to be some discussion. I will guarantee you we're going to try to go next year, our proposal that'll have an eight-week schedule, keep the conferences, and then get more teams in the playoffs, 48 per class instead of 32 per class, which adds more teams to get in. Then you're looking at teams that will be most likely 4-4 and 3-5s would get into the playoffs. So teams under 500 would have a chance to play in a playoff.
It's starting to sound like the NBA, but I know where you're going with this, getting more teams involved.
But is that
really the essence of what you want to do? I mean, playoff games are supposed to be important games. Aren't you kind of, you know, I can't get the right word for this. Lou, help me out here.
Good morning. First of all, good morning and happy holidays to everybody.
You too, Lou.
Hey, welcome
Lou. You know what I'm trying to say here? You're watering down is what I'm thinking about. Watering down the playoffs.
Diluting
the playoffs.
And every team doesn't need to eat a trophy.
Right. Well, it isn't even so much that, but you're going to wind up with a 3-5 team playing a 7-1 team, and you know how that's going to go. And you don't want that to happen in the playoffs. You would rather have it during the regular season. Maybe they play against somebody that's a higher caliber just to get an experience of where they stand. But to do it in the playoffs, I don't know that I'm totally with that.
You know, even now with the 32-team bracket, I mean, those first games are not, you know, hugely competitive, are they?
Well, not in all cases.
Well, they've got like 1-32 and 7-8.
I'll give you an example. Not in all cases, because this year, first round game, I got Maine South and Loyola. Uh-huh. You never would expect to see that happen that early in the season, and that changed the whole course of the.
Because Loyola lost to Mirrors for a second
time.
That's why it happened.
That happened.
Yeah. But you'll often get a.
Kind of like Warren played Plainfield East, and they won 49-7, and that game was over at halftime, actually. It was over. So I know what you're saying. You're going to get some games that are going to be routes, but sometimes you might get those matchups. But I think what the IHSA and some schools want, they just want to see the better representation of more schools involved, the more watering down to get more trophies to different schools. But the only problem I have, and I know Lou's going to bite at me on this, is that the thing is, the private schools seem to get away with more than the public schools. For example, you know, the private schools, take a look how many private schools that make it there year in, year out, and there's schools like Round Lake, a Waukegan that can never get their footing to be better because of the competition. So that's not there to help them. Maybe you can get public schools to go down in class on the fact that they haven't been able to do anything in their classes. But people are going to scream, wait a minute, Waukegan's 4,600. Why should they be 7A or 6A? Well, the private schools do it all the time. Oh, they don't have success in a couple years. They can waver now. Just like, you know, you see Mount Carmel's and a few other schools going down, St. Rita, a few others going down to 5A or 6A when they normally were 7A or 8A, with the exception of Notre Dame that went 6A to 8A this year.
And Phillips bumped up, too, the last 2 years.
First of all, I mean, you hit a number of issues there. And maybe this is not the place to talk about the equality in education. But when you have a tax base that is supposed to support the public schools, there's inequality built in. Now, I'm not for that, because I think there should be equal education access for all.
But that's a real look at it, though.
But that's a real look at it. So therefore, we'll just take out the private schools, Stevenson, Libertyville, Nutrier, are going to be able to do a lot more for their programs and their kids than, you know, and obviously the Chicago Public Schools will say, which don't have that money coming in to support huge facilities and coaches.
And to your point, let's take a school like Libertyville. Let's take a school like Waukegan or North Chicago. If I'm an AD and I'm scheduling my games and I've got a long way to go and I'm Libertyville and I got to go out to Chesney Park, Harlem, to play them in Rockford, okay?
Yeah.
I'm scheduling my bus. I've got to get my teams out of school at a certain time. If I'm Libertyville, probably not that difficult because I can afford to book those buses. If I'm North Chicago and for some reason we're having issues in getting those buses, being able to pay for those buses and getting those kids on those buses, that's a whole different perspective.
Well, I mean, to go beyond that, I mean, Lyle has played in Ireland, okay, and plays out of state. But the interesting reason that they've been playing out of state, especially that opening game, is that nobody wants to play them. Nobody wants to get beat up, you know, like 70 to nothing.
Right.
But also, on the other hand, Don, what you're pointing out, which is a problem, and I think Carmel was involved in it a few years back. Rusty will remember this. We had some bad storms opening weekend.
Yes.
And Lincoln Way had had come up to Carmel, and and the storms hit. The games are called off,
and they have to go back.
Well, they have to go back.
That's like Warren going to Glenbard North.
And they have to come back the next day.
Yeah, but Warren.
I have family out in Lincoln Way. And I live right by Carmel, and I don't even like to take the trip once. Not that I hope my family isn't listening. I love you, but I don't like the ride.
But the thing is, it's like Warren went to Glenbard North what, three times in one week on Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. You get completed the game. It's a big area. It's got a lot of people in it. Traveling is part of the agenda, which is a tough situation.
Well, now suppose that was North Chicago that had to do what Warren had to do. Could they have afforded it?
Could they
have organized it like Warren? Could they have got the kids there on time? See, that puts a different pressure on them than a Warren or a Libertyville.
Well, and again, Libertyville, logistically, they can handle it. Stevenson can handle it. Loyola logistically can handle it. But still, and Don, I think, will agree with me, they don't want to take that long trip.
No.
They don't want to get out at 3 o'clock. You have to get everybody on the bus.
Smart coaches don't want to do that.
Yeah, don't want to do that.
Ruins your pregame routine.
And part of it is the consideration there.
Wow, yeah. I feel like the little professor who lit the fire and watched it burn.
Yeah, I know. Believe me, we'll talk more about this with the proposals where we go further with it. 20 minutes past the hour of 9 o'clock. I do want to talk about high school basketball last night because the game that we had here on WRLR, Lake Forest at Warren, the lone game in the Northern, in the North Suburban Conference last night, because everybody else is getting ready for holiday tournaments, holiday breaks. And I give a lot of credit to these kids, because I don't know if you realize, this is finals week. Who really wants to be playing basketball when you got to study on your finals and actually do that? But
I thought that was finals week.
No, this past week was finals week for majority of the schools, because everyone's going, you know, they start in August early, and they go right before the holidays, and you have it. But maybe this is also a good way to kind of let those finals out in a game. And I give a lot of credit to Lake Forest last night. I saw Lake Forest last week look horrible against Lake Zurich. And they came out scoring like a machine last night. They had the first 8 points of the game. They jumped out to a 10-2 lead. Warren came back 14-13 at the end of the first quarter. Another 12-2 run by Lake Forest again. And they had a 26-15 lead by halftime. Warren tried to come back. They got within 4 points in the second half, twice in the fourth quarter, before Lake Forest went on to win by a score of 55-44. I got to mention, Lake Forest has got a freshman by the name of Asa Thomas, 6'4". Keep an eye on this kid. Long, lengthy. This kid can play. He can shoot the basketball. Had 21 points last night, one off his career high, which he had 22 against St. Ignatius just a few weeks ago. He's only played more than a handful of games here so far. And yet he's making a statement to help out, you know, Lake Forest. And I give a lot of credit in the world to Phil Escala. Great coach. They have not had the talent there like they had a few years past. And Don knows who I'm talking about. Evan Boudreau is one of them that stands out like a sore thumb. He went to play in a few different colleges, but went to the Ivy League first. You know, great player, big player, strong player. He played around the time when Jalen Brunson was around. But Lake Forest really hasn't had that type of competition. But Here's a team. Both these teams are about, you know, a couple games under 500. Lake Forest hadn't won a game in the conference. They've lost their first two, but they're pretty good. So the key thing is, you know, keep an eye on both these teams. But Lake Forest, I like very well the way they played. I did catch up with Phil Escalo after the game.
What did you think of this game, the way the team played?
Yeah, I thought we responded great from last Friday night, you know. Yeah, I thought we were, last Friday, we were sluggish and didn't defend really well and just, like, you know. And tonight we got after it. And getting off to a good start always helps, obviously, and making some shots helps, you know.
I mean, I would say they came at you at the end of the first quarter.
Yeah.
You responded.
Yep.
You got a nice lead by half. They came at you again by the end of the third quarter,
made some nice runs. You know, and they're going to be a good team down the stretch. Once, you know, they start, they just got those football guys back. And once they get those guys playing, they're gonna be a quality team. I mean, and that De La Cruz is a load inside. I mean, and the other kid, 34 Sorenchik, they're tough players. I mean, so once they get their chemistry, I think they're going to be really tough in the North Suburban. You know, I'm lucky to play them early here. You know,
one thing I will say, he is talking about the three football players from Warren. And when you put football players on a basketball court, it takes time to learn how to play basketball compared to what you did when you played football. And I'll be honest, the referees knew that those guys were football players out there last night because they're throwing their bodies around. They're throwing the arms around. You can do that on a football field and get away with it. On the basketball court, it's a bit different where these referees are midseason form. They're very touchy on the fouls. You know, you throw an elbow, you throw a shoulder, you know, you throw the arm out. They're going to call that stuff. And, you know, Juan De La Cruz, he's right. He had 12 points to lead the team last night, and I was impressed by the way he played. But, you know, Seamus Mellican, he's still got some work to do. Jason Turner, it looked pretty good, too, out there on the court, but not to the level of where they want him.
Yeah, I agree with you. That transition's got to happen. But it does help in physicality. In rebounding, blocking out, you know, when you have a football-type player, athlete that's playing basketball, they tend to eat up space on the floor, and they're good rebounders. And that helps with your defensive side. Now, as far as the savvy and the ability to get to the basket and not foul people, that's the part you have to work on coming from football.
Not exactly having a great touch often from their spot on the floor. Uh-huh. But also the point was, too, and this helped some other programs that bring in football players. If you're out of the playoffs earlier, you get more gym time on the guys. You know what I'd like to mention? On Facebook, I mentioned it to Don. I had to congratulate him because his Evanston Wildcats were at the top. But go look at the top 20, 25 schools now. The suburbs are well represented when they necessarily haven't been in the past.
Yeah, before we get to that, because I've got our top five list, we'll get into that. But I do want to make mention of John Jasnock, because the coach of Warren, about the situation with the football players, because he did comment that to me after the game. And, yeah, they didn't get a win, but this team better get ready quick, because they're going to be at Pontiac coming up this week for the holiday tournament. And you know how tough that tournament is. But John Jasnock spoke to me about the players.
I was going to say, they got off to an awfully quick start on me.
They did. They were playing very well. They were playing very good defense, pressuring us. And we did not handle that very well. A couple times we had guys open inside, and we didn't find them because of some of the pressure on us. And then we missed a lot of inside shots in the first half. That was we got some good shots inside and we missed them. And then there's others that we didn't see guys that were open inside. They, on the other hand, did a nice job of finding each other. They played really good team offense. They found each other. They finished well. And I think then, you know, when we got down a little bit, we started pressing a little bit. We tried to do too much. We had some guys try to do a little bit too much, and you know, that never works very well.
I was say, it was a good comeback. You only had 2 points in that second quarter to try to close it down in the third and the fourth quarter to, what, four? And then they pulled away late.
Yeah, again, you know, that's just it. They you know, they kept grinding out, running good team offense. We got, you know, we were looking inside, but we were just trying to get too much too fast. Again, you know, where we wanted to get the ball in so quickly, we weren't making good passes. We were trying to force it inside. So.
The football players,
it's still a work in progress trying to get the flow going?
Yeah. I mean, you know, it takes a little while to get your shots. Some of that we saw in the first half, missing some inside shots. But, you know, Juan got it going in the second half and inside and found his touch around the rim again. And, yeah, I think it's just going to be a it just takes time. You know, it's a very, you know, two very different sports. So to get your timing down just takes a little while. So, but, you know, they do a lot, you know, all the other good things, you know, defense and rebounding and screening and all those good things, you know, they're doing it. Just like I said, shooting takes a little longer.
Going down to Pontiac, how much do you think that'll help the team?
I think it'll help, like I said, you know, teams are, you know, we play a lot of big, strong, physical teams there, and I think we're going to be physical and strong and able to handle that. We just got to play a little smarter. You know, tonight we didn't always play smart, and I guess Lake Forest did. So we'll have to play smarter when we're in Pontiac.
All right, Coach John Jasny. Warren's coming along. They're coming along. I think they'll be okay. Once they get back from Pontiac and you get back to the North Suburban, it will be good. I want to run through the other games here if we can. In the Central Suburban North, they had a bunch of games going on. Niles North beat Vernon Hills 78-51. That was after Vernon Hills had a nice win over Rochelle Zell out of Deerfield on Thursday night. So they couldn't face up to Niles North. Highland Park, keep an eye on this team. This Giants team is playing some good basketball. They beat Maine East last night 58-37, but they have now knocked off, outside of Maine East, Niles North and Deerfield last week in overtime. So this might be the team to watch. Paul Harris, again, showing us that he can be a good coach. He's been a long-time coach over there for the Giants. And, you know, a lot of times we leave him off the radar down there in the southeast corner of the county. So keep an eye on Highland Park. Deerfield got a win over Maine West, 51-41. Stevenson victorious last night. They only beat Yorkville Christian, who was, believe it or not, the same record as they were, 8-1. 74-38. Not a bad game. Matt Kasnikoff with 18, leading the way for the Stevenson Patriots. Lakes lost to Kenosha Bradford 54-51. And here's a surprise for you guys. You ready for this? North Chicago and Waukegan met each other. And believe it or not, the Warhawks beat the Bulldogs 58-56. And I can't remember the last time North Chicago beat Waukegan in a head-to-head matchup on the basketball court. It's been a long time. So congratulations to the Warhawks with that big win. Even though it's non-conference, nice job.
Tough year so far for Waukegan out of the gate.
They got a win earlier this week over Lakes.
Yeah, but
part of the MLK.
One win.
Yeah, one win so far. North Chicago, that's their third win. They've got wins over Lakes and Antioch in overtime. So I still wonder who's going to win that NLCC. I think it's a wide-open race this year, the way Round Lake's playing. I want to give credit to Round Lake, 7-2 right now, and they are playing some great basketball. Let's see what they can do. I think they're playing out in Marengo tournament this coming week. On the girls' side, the Libertyville Holiday Tournament's going on. Rolling Meadows beat Vernon Hills 53-47. Libertyville got a win over Niles West 40-27. They are playing some great basketball, the Libertyville Wildcats. Could be the favorite. I think Conant might challenge them for the tournament, which we will have the third place and the final coming up next Thursday afternoon at 1 and 2:30. 1 o'clock will be the third place game. 2:30 will be the final. We've been going over there the last few years, keeping an eye on the girls in that tournament. So one other game last night, Grays Lake Central beat Harvard 56-28. And the Northern Holiday Classic, Grays Lake North fell to Woodstock North 51-34. Non-conference game, Deerfield got beat by Maine West 51-28. And one other game in the Northern Holiday Classic, Johnsburg beat Lakes by a score of 38-20.
You were talking about the resurgence of the Round Lake program, girls basketball. Lily Burton, 24 points last night, big win. The girls, we've been talking about how...
Well, the boys are doing well, yeah.
And the girls won last big. So it's nice to see that their programs are improving.
Mm. Games today, let's go through these. Non-conference, Hersey at Lake Forest, 5:30. Big game over at Mundelein. You might want to check this one out. Lake Park and Mundelein go at each other at 6 o'clock. Both teams are 9-0. This should be good. St. Patrick, Providence St. Mel against Carmel. That's 11:30 this morning. Jacobs Tournament Grant will take on Peyton at 3 o'clock. Jacobs, the host team, will take on Grays Lake Central at 7:30. Out in Marengo, Belvedere, Wakanda, 1:30 this afternoon. Round Lake will take on the Pretzels from Freeport. Yes, Bruce, that is actually their name.
Pretzels. First thing that popped into my head is pretzels.
Pretzels. Want to pass this on to Hinsdale Central Tournament. Stevenson will open up on Monday afternoon against Glenbrook North as one of the favorites. I think Marion Catholic might be the other favorite in that one. Wheeling, Libertyville will take on Elgin at 9 o'clock in the morning. Can you picture getting out there?
Wake up call.
Yeah, well, last year I remember Waukegan did that. And they had a shoot around at 5:30 before that game, and they beat Grays Lake Central handily. Deerfield and Prospect will be at 2. Niles North Waukegan at 3:45 in that tournament. Down in Bloomington, the State Farm Classic, North Chicago will open up with Normal. That'll be right after Christmas. Carmel's going down to Centralia. They'll open up with Champaign Central. That'll be also after Christmas. Down in Pontiac, Warren will take on Peoria Manuals, who they open up with right after Christmas at 10:30 in the morning. Proviso West is where you'll find Zion Benton taking on Dunbar the day after Christmas at 7 o'clock. Highland Park will be at taking on Solaria at the Jack Tosh Tournament. That's a 32-team tournament. They'll open up at 9 o'clock in the morning right after Christmas. Good luck with that game. And I think Lake Forest is also out there, and they are. They'll play Timothy Christian at 6 o'clock. Lake Zurich is down at Pekin. And then Lakes and Vernon Hills will be playing at the Maine East Tournament. And Grace Lake North does not play in a tournament, by the way, at all, a holiday tournament.
Rest their legs.
That's the way it's been for the last few years.
Yeah.
So our top five list, let's go through these. On the girls' side, top team Lake Forest, Libertyville second, Lake Zurich third, Grace Lake Central four, and Carmel five. Stevenson right on the edge looking in. By the way, Stevenson Patriot girls will be out at the Dundee Crown Classic, which Maine West is favored again. Top five boys. At number five, I've got Round Lake there. Hello. 7-2. Round Lake in the top five.
You're coming.
Number four, Highland Park. Number three, Libertyville. Number two, and number one, you guys are going to fight over this, I think. Number two, even though they haven't taken a loss yet, I've got Mundelein there. Stevenson at number one, because Stevenson's games, yeah, they lost to Oak Park River Forest, a very good team, last week. You could make a
strength of
complaint.
Schedule.
Yeah, I mean, you could complain on the side and say maybe Mundelein deserves to be number one, but if they played Lake Park last night and proved to me that they won last night, I would say so, because Mundelein didn't beat Zion Benton as much as Stevenson did, but it was a nice win, though. They came from behind 11 back on Monday night. I was out there for that game. Great game. They beat Zion Benton 52-48. I would almost consider that as being 1A, 1B right now.
Being a Mustang, I won't complain. I would like them to see them beat a top conference
team. Of course you do. Of course you would. Because you had somebody that went there, right?
Yes. I live across the street, as you know.
Well,
hard to root against that, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right, guys, we got to take a break. We'll come back, and we got a special guest coming back. Somebody who used to be a part of our staff here. I was an intern at one time, now up in Milwaukee. We'll talk about the Bucks, the NBA. The Bulls aren't much to talk about, but we'll talk about that, the Blackhawks.
Who?
And some guy by the name of Mike McCarthy, we're going to find where in the world he is because we're missing today. We're going to find him,
too. We need
some
soccer time.
We'll talk about that, too, before we're done.
I got a whole list.
Yeah, I know you do. Back right after this here on WRLR.
The party's on. The feeling's here. That only comes this time of year.
You're listening to 98.3 FM, WRLR LP, Round Lake, Illinois.
WRLR is community radio.
I feel much more informed with what's happening today.
When we say community, we really mean it.
It's not like corporate, and it's just a good station, you know?
We don't belong to some large corporation that makes a profit from this station.
Because I like the diversity.
And listeners won't be forced to listen to large blocks of advertising. Operations at community radio stations are made possible through grants and underwriting from companies within this area of operation. And donations, funds, and equipment, services, and time from area residents who volunteer their time to get involved.
It's as if it's my next-door neighbor talking to me, only he's on the radio instead of next door to me.
Real people just like you.
I like them. They tell it like it is.
Local focus, local news, local music, of the local people and by the local people.
It's different than the rest of the stuff I hear.
I love the show. I listen every day.
WRLR. Cornicione's New York Style Pizzeria in Antioch at Routes 83 and 173 is another proud sponsor of WRLR Sports. Cornicione's pizza dough is made from scratch using a family recipe that originated in Brooklyn, New York. Their dough is proofed at least 24 hours. Cornicione's menu includes pizzas, calzones, pasta, much more. They have dine-in, carry-out, and delivery. Their number is 224-308-1499.
What's it like to walk in the shoes of a Navy SEAL, a beekeeper, a rabbi, a dentist, a ghost hunter, or a professional clown? Join me, Jim Wunderlich, on Word of Mouth, Thursday mornings from 11 a.m. to noon, and hear their stories. Captivating guests from a wide range of professions sharing a behind-the-curtain view of their jobs. Jobs such as an interrogator from Guantanamo, a private chef, a film director, a doctor, an orchestra conductor, a college basketball coach.
Today's sports broadcast is made possible by O'Keefe Lewis and Bruno PC, proud to sponsor another season of Lake County High School sports broadcasts on WRLR 98.3 FM, helping home buyers, sellers, and others with real estate transactions. O'Keefe Lewis and Bruno PC can be reached at 847-675-4790.
Want to fight childhood asthma? Then fight it with a scrub brush and a hot soapy towel. Even in the neatest and tidiest homes, if there's so much as a crumb to eat or a drop to drink, household pests like bugs and mice will do all that they can to get it. Creepy crawlies like bugs and mice are unpleasant enough as it is, but they're more than just a nuisance for kids with asthma because they can actually trigger an asthma attack. So, give them a whole lot of nothing. Sweep up crumbs, wipe down tables, scrub dishes before they pile up in the sink, and store leftovers in plastic bags or bowls. Don't leave them so much as one tidbit or nibble, and you can stop a childhood asthma attack before it starts. Discover other simple ways to prevent an asthma attack. Call 1-866-NO-ATTACKS or visit noattacks.org, because no child should feel like a fish out of water. A public service message brought to you by the U.S. EPA, the Ad Council, and this station.
You're listening to 98.3 FM, WRLR LP, Round Lake, Illinois.
Welcome back to the Sports Corner. Sports guys, for a Saturday morning, 34 degrees outside. Plenty of sunshine out there, mostly sunny today, high up to about 47, down to about 32 tonight, and then right back to the same area tomorrow. We'll try to bump that temperature up a few more degrees over the next few days till Christmas. 50s for Christmas? Wow. I just can't handle this. This is unbelievable. Gotta love it. I feel like it's spring out here.
Hey, I should say that the sports department made the Christmas, the WRLR Christmas party, and, you know, kept it going into the next day.
You're right. Yeah, we did stay late.
That's right. We did kind of
stay late.
My wife said,
hung
like,
around for a while,
have they gone home yet? I said, no, they're still watching.
Yeah, that was
TV.
A long night. Yeah, especially since we had the
that was great
banquet the next
great
day.
Great food.
Yeah, that was a great opportunity. Thanks.
That was good.
No, we had a good time.
So
it was
more help cleaning up next time.
Yeah. Just say when. Yeah.
Hey guys, time to talk a little NBA if we can, and we're gonna go talk to a buddy of ours. No, we're gonna talk not about the Bulls. We're talking about the Bucks.
Thank God.
Because we have a gentleman with us, the guy that was on this show. We helped him along, and now he's working up in Milwaukee, believe it or not, these days. We talk to him every now and then. Ashton Robin, how you doing, Ashton?
I'm good, guys. How you doing this morning?
Doing great. Ashton. You Marvelous. Sound great too. I'll say this. I'm glad we helped you out, because now you're in the big business and we're still sitting here.
Big business. All right, we'll call it big business. I'll take it. Yeah, so I would not be where I was without you guys.
So, hey, Ashton, how exciting was that game the other night? Because the Bucks took on the Lakers. And look at the gaudy record. Look at the way both of these teams have been playing this year. I mean, that had to be an exciting game for all the Bucks fans lately. Maybe for the Lakers fans, too.
It was, and you know, the funny thing is, the Bucks obviously had an 18-game winning streak heading into the week. They played the Mavericks and lost on Monday. A lot of the fans, we spent pretty much most of the day Monday ignoring the game, saying, look, it doesn't really matter if they win this game or not. Been talking about the Lakers game for about 2 weeks. Once they were on the streak and it was reaching 14, 15 games, it was okay. They got to play somebody. The Lakers are coming up on the 19th. This is a game everyone's looking forward to. Like, the hype was there. I have not experienced any hype for an NBA regular season game in probably my entire life watching basketball. It was very different.
Mm-hmm. I guess it was kind of festive, thinking maybe it was like an NBA Finals. Could that be a possibility? Are people talking about that up there?
Yeah, I mean, of course. I mean, that's been the talk, of course, before the season. There's obviously the talk of the Bucks and Sixers playing on Christmas Day, and that could be a possible Eastern Conference Finals preview. But the Bucks, Lakers, and of course, when the Bucks played the Clippers a couple of weeks ago, these are the two big stories. These are the matchups that people want to see. Like, hey, if the Bucks are quote unquote for real, they got to start winning these games against these teams. Why they have to prove anything in the regular season, I don't know, but that's kind of what it's become, is they have to beat the big-name teams and the big-name players, and they have.
You know, Ashton, I got to ask this question because it was kind of a tailspin what happened last year against Toronto. Is this team, or how much does this team have that hunger feeling that they want to go farther this year than what happened at the end of last year?
It's incredible. I mean, that's all they pretty much talked about in the offseason, and you see, anytime Giannis was working out, he said he kept all he was thinking about when he was working out was the games against Kawhi and how Kawhi could beat him one-on-one and how the Raptors defensively were able to contain him and how maybe if he passed the ball a little bit better, was a little bit more accurate with his and capable with his decision-making. He is very much a guy that is cerebral in the fact that he knows what he wants in front of him. And he says, okay, I need to do X to be better myself. I need to do X to be a better teammate and make better plays for my other teammates. It's been kind of top of mind for not only Giannis as the reigning MVP and the pretty much leader of the MVP right now, probably, but also for the rest of the guys. They're bringing back pretty much everybody except for Malcolm Brogdon, and they brought in Robin Lopez. They brought in Wesley Matthews. They brought in Kyle Korver. Those are three veteran names. Kyle Korver, who has been in the NBA Finals, they did pretty much everything they could to say, okay, here are guys that have been here before. Take any advice that they can give you and do whatever they say.
I think you're correct. It's akin to kind of what the Bulls did in the early phases of Michael Jordan's career when they were struggling. And he had to learn that it's important that you have to find the complementary pieces. So when you get to that point in the game, a John Paxson can step up and shoot the three-pointer, B.J. Armstrong, Craig Hodges. You saw him make the careers of those guards because they understood each other's role. Michael understood that when the double team collapsed on him, or the triple team, when he goes to the basket, Paxson can bury the shot when he has to. And that's the understanding that Giannis is getting, I believe. You see the maturity. It's about leadership. I think he understands that, and he's going to press his teammates to be better. But when you get a veteran like a Kyle Korver who can bury that shot and be a compliment to him in the critical games, it's not the games where they're supposed to win. It's the close games where those guys have to step up and understand their role.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely, that's a great point. And, you know, another guy that doesn't get mentioned enough, I don't think, nationally, because he's a bench guy, is George Hill. George Hill has been phenomenal since he came to the Bucks a year ago when he was traded from the Cavaliers. He is leading the NBA with, I believe, 51.6% from three, which is kind of incredible. It doesn't get talked about. He makes half of his three-point attempts, which is huge in the Bucks system because under Mike Budenholzer, that's what they do. It's let it fly. That's kind of his saying. It's let it fly. Either you're going to get a good shot in the paint or you're going to take the shot from outside. That's the new NBA, but that's also the efficiency under the Mike Budenholzer system, is we're going to take whatever shot we feel is best. And George Hill has taken that to the umpteenth degree where he has just said, okay, if I can drive to the lane and lead the bench unit when Giannis is out or when Chris Middleton is out or when Eric Bledsoe is out like he is right now with an injury, or if he can take the shot from three, George Hill has been kind of this huge leader. The other night, when the game was not unraveling, but it was getting tighter against the Lakers, it was George Hill at 21 points off the bench. He was able to kind of keep that second unit in the game. And he has been a bigger piece to this than I think people have realized kind of nationally, because George Hill is he doesn't speak a lot. He doesn't say much. He doesn't talk to the media a whole lot. He does 2-minute media sessions after the game. He's very much like just look ahead, look ahead, look ahead. So he's been a huge part of this team.
Mm-hmm. You know, before I let you go, I got to ask this question, Ashton. Because the Bucks are playing well, the Packers are headed to the playoffs again. The Brewers have looked like, you know, pretty good the last couple of years, getting, you know, to the playoffs here and there. But the thing is, along with the Badgers too, who's the favorite team in Wisconsin these days?
I mean, do you really have to ask that question?
I mean, hey, want to move to Wisconsin.
Much to my chagrin, it will forever be until the Bucks win a title, or until the Brewers win a World Series, at least make a World Series, it will forever be a Packers state followed by the Brewers and the Bucks.
If you'd asked him that question, a couple of days ago, you'd have had to say Wisconsin Whitewater.
I mean, yeah, well, they certainly get to play when they're in the title games, even though I know they lost last night. But they get to play the couple of weeks leading up to these games when they start doing well, everyone starts talking about them. But it kind of stinks because here I am. I've been up in Milwaukee for 5 years now. I've been trying to, as someone who loves the NBA, I've been trying to say, hey, look, the Bucks, look where they've gotten, and now it's taken 4 or 5 years for everyone to realize, oh, we have this incredible team here in the city. Let's go and support them. And the last couple of seasons has been great. The new arena opening up, Pfizer Forum. So I think the fandom for the Bucks has skyrocketed. Uh-huh. It's just it's still not the Packers or Brewers because they're very different audiences.
Uh-huh. All right, Ashton, appreciate it. Hey, we still love you down here because I know you're from Grays Lake originally. We know that.
Yeah, I heard. I was listening a little bit earlier. Is that the Lady Rams or the boys team that's doing pretty well in hoops?
The girls are doing a lot better than the boys, but they're still not bad. You got a new coach in there on the boys' side, Brian Santella, who used to play at Grays Lake years ago. I don't know if you remember him. Or maybe an old buddy of yours.
He was track coach, I think, or his brother's a track coach there.
Yeah, so kind of some old head there for you. So, well, thanks, Ashton.
Good for that. Glad to hear it.
All right. Thanks, Ashton. We'll talk to you soon. Happy holidays, by the way.
Merry Christmas.
Nice job, Ashton.
Yeah, you as well, guys. Thank you. Take care.
All right, Ashton Robin, who at one time, believe it or not, was an intern on this station and he went to Bowling Green State, came here and worked on his broadcast career as an intern, and then he moved up to Wisconsin. I think he's at TMJ, and he's working with ESPN up there.
WRLR is a great place to be, and so many people are volunteering. It's just amazing.
Well, new people coming up. I'll tell you one thing. The best part about Ashton was he's about the size as Don. I mean, I'll serious. I know Don never met him, but he was like our bouncer for the station. I'll be honest. Anytime I went out with him to games, I wasn't worried because he would. He's a big guy. He's really a big guy, but he's got a great work ethic and a great voice. And he's finally getting his due. It's took him 5 years. He's working his way up, and that's what you got to do in the industry. You got to work your way there.
You're right.
Can I sum up the NBA in 30 seconds or less?
The Bulls are playing Detroit tonight.
The Bulls are 2 games out of a playoff spot. Enough said.
No.
Yes. Yes.
No.
Yeah.
No.
Yeah.
Okay. You're probably right.
Yeah. Look how far out the Bulls are from their last spot.
Right behind Indiana and Detroit.
Yeah. 2 games. And we all know they're a man-made disaster.
Oh, God. I thought talking about the Bulls would last about 0.68 seconds.
I said it's a statement on the NBA.
By the way, the Bulls did win a game the other night and actually came from behind to do it.
Newsflash.
Yeah, that was a surprise because I know I've been talking about the last couple of weeks how many games they lose when they take a lead for most of the game and they lose it in the fourth quarter.
Well, I thought I was listening to the sports guys when I was listening to the broadcast,
yep.
And they were talking about Gar, and they said they and Pax, that they need to go packing, that they really need to.
Well, apparent rumor is that some of the executives do want to leave but aren't being allowed to.
Let me just throw this in. I won't give a name or another station or anything like that. Rusty knows this. When the Bulls were down 26 points, the proposition bet was +945, and somebody took that bet. Guess what happened?
Hey, we should mention on the air, for a lot of your WRLR programs and almost all the sports, subscribe to our YouTube channel, and you'll be able to listen again. So if you've enjoyed the show and really want to hear everybody once more, go there. You missed a call of the game last night. It'll be posted. And all your other Golden Sports Show will be up there.
It's like radio on demand.
Exactly.
It is.
It's good.
Mm-hmm.
It's like your
and speaking
podcast.
On demand, believe it or not, if we're going to find it, where in the world is Michael McCarthy for a quick couple minutes? Mike, where are you, buddy?
You got some stats for me, Mike?
Hey, what's happening, guys?
Where are you is the question.
I'm in Athens, Georgia. Kirby Smart asked me to come down there and help get ready for a
Bulldogs.
So that's what I'm doing.
I thought you were doing some NASCAR. That's
Mike, I want to ask you a question. Have you been to a Waffle House?
What's that?
Have you been to the Waffle House yet? I have to prove that you were there.
Were you at a Waffle House yet?
No. I haven't been to a Waffle House yet. That might be on the agenda here at some point. I got to get something smothered and covered. Oh,
what is the meal of the weekend? And we're waiting for that picture.
I did go to the varsity, though, yesterday, and you'd be happy to know I was in Clemson.
I've been there. I've been there. You were in Atlanta.
And then, of course, went to the ESO Club when I was in Clemson. So I've been hitting all the hot spots for sure.
All right.
Now, wait a minute. You're leaving tomorrow, I heard, from Athens. Where are you going?
We are going to Ireland. So we're going to be in Dublin on Christmas, and then we're also going to travel around. I'm going to drive on the other side of the road for about 7 days.
Good luck for those people.
Oh, wow.
You're used to that, aren't you?
Hey, Mike, where do we want
to? Wow, double barrels.
Have you been to Ireland before?
So we'll be in Ireland, Northern Ireland, and then I'll be home New Year's Day.
Have you been to Ireland before?
I've already got my plans to watch the national semifinal games at 1 in the morning Ireland time. I got my VPN, so I'm gonna fool my iPad into thinking that it's in the U.S. and I can watch the ESPN feed of the games.
Now, the question that Lou was trying to offer to you is, have you been to Ireland before?
I have. Yes, I've been there. Cool. It was 29 years ago. It was for about 3 days, so I need to refamiliarize myself with everything.
Now, how much farther ahead is Ireland from here? Do you know
Six hours.
It is 6 hours.
Six, okay. So make sure you catch up on your sleep on your way there.
I'm going to try. we will be hit the first priority on Monday when we get there because things are a lot of stuff is closed the 24th and 25th, of course. However, we are going to the Guinness Brewery and doing the brewery tour and maybe a little bit of imbibing on the 23rd.
You just call us from the Guinness Brewery when you get there.
Isn't that a great word?
Yeah. All right.
Guinness is so good there.
Hey, Mike, we'll catch up with you next week, all right, if we can.
All right, guys. Thanks for checking in.
I really want to see if this is going to work.
Happy holidays, Mike.
All right, thanks,
Mike. Cheers, brother.
Thank you, guys. Happy holidays.
Bring me some home brew. Bring it back.
Hey, Lou, we only got a couple minutes. Let's talk a little bit about soccer, if we can, here quickly. Chicago Fire got a new technical director as of,
announced yesterday.
Yeah, well, it was announced
very
quickly.
George Heights,
one of the two heads. Yeah, I want to say that. He's from the Swiss League. What have FC we found Basel. Out about him?
He's got an outstanding record there. I think some people are saying the Swiss League. That was an outstanding program there. Made the Champions League by being virtue of winning the Swiss League. And it would advance a number of years. He developed a good number of people there that have gone on to star at other bigger programs throughout Europe. He's going to be in charge of the organization on the pitch side from top to bottom, first team down through their developmental leagues. I like the choice. And additionally, if you're following what's going on in the European leagues, I follow mainly the English league, there's been huge coaching turnover this season. Some big names have been released from big programs. I don't know if he's thinking of landing one of those guys, but there are some huge coaching names available that maybe he can bring over. Our new owner here, Joe Mansueto, seems to be committed money. One of the questions Rusty always had, along with a lot of other Chicago fans, what would happen with Nelson Rodriguez? That came as predicted, Rusty. Lou told you first he would move to the business side. See, he is. But they got to put together a roster real quick and a head coach. The schedule is out, which also has some interesting things.
All right. One thing I do want to mention, I did see some quotes coming from the new sporting director. He did mention he will find a coach quickly. He's not going to waste any time.
They're available.
Yeah, well, he's going to find. It may be out within the next few days. That's what I've heard from his direct comment. And then also he's going to formulate a roster. He doesn't have much time. Training camp, believe it or not, is within a month. So you will see more names coming into play. The question is what kind of players we get, what kind of chemistry we get. That's going to be down the road.
The European transfer window is going to be opening up, so which is sort of like free agency in baseball.
Couple other soccer notes you want to throw in?
No, down inside.
Did you see that fabulous play by Cristiano Ronaldo elevating over the top of a player? Waist high, and then he heads the ball into the net. I saw that on the highlights. It was the most fabulous athletic play I've ever seen.
Yeah, so some of the headers, and then, of course, the bicycle kicks. Just, you say, go, wow.
We got a new player for the Chicago Red Stars coming from Sporting Kansas City. The name escapes me. Doniak, I believe the name is. We'll see if she can be fitting in the shoes of Sam Kerr. That's going to be a tough thing to do because she was a great player.
A big void with Sam Kerr leaving. But, hey, the wrestling guys will be back in the ring.
I know they missed last week. They're outside.
They had a commitment last week, so they'll be back in. Zach, where's Al?
He's coming up next.
Is Al there?
He's coming up next.
Where's Dick the Bruiser?
Baron Von Rusty. Where's Dick the Bruiser getting at?
Crusher. All right, we got to get going here.
Listen again. Subscribe to our YouTube
Rusty,
channel.
Yeah. One note, 8 weeks to pitchers and catchers.
Spring training, you're right around the corner.
8 weeks away.
And we didn't talk much about the Blackhawks, but Blackhawks are finding ways to win. They beat Winnipeg the other night, so that was good.
Hey,
so.
Thanks for everyone that came out last week for our benefit concert.
Great show.
With AX and the Man.
Great band.
I want to tell you, when Don walked in the place, everybody knew him.
Cheers.
He was signing autographs. Don's I heard about it.
Yeah,
so. Hey, we got to thank a few people. Steve Brandy. Also want to thank Ashton Rodman, Jason McKee. I know we can catch up with him, but, hey, congratulations being the head coach over at Carmel. Thanks to Kevin the Swamp Rat. Thanks to Don.
Thank you, Bruce.
The fourth peel. Lou.
Happy holidays, everybody.
And to everybody out there, enjoy your holiday season.
Happy holidays.
Be safe. And we want to see you for next year. We'll be back next week. I'm Rusty Silber. So long, everybody.
You're listening to 98.3 FM, WRLR LP, Round Lake, Illinois.
WRLR is community radio.
I feel much more informed with what's happening today.
When we say community, we really mean it.
It's not like corporate, and it's just a good station, you know?
We don't belong to some large corporation that makes a profit from this station.
Because I like the diversity.
And listeners won't be forced to listen to large blocks of advertising. Operations at community radio stations are made possible through grants and underwriting from companies within this area of operation. And donations, funds, and equipment, services, and time from area residents who volunteer their time to get involved.
It's as if it's my next-door neighbor talking to me, only he's on the radio instead of next door to me.
Real people just like you.
I like them. They tell it like it is.
Local focus, local news, local music, of the local people and by the local people.
It's different than the rest of the stuff I hear.
I love the show. I listen every day.
WRLR.
Having trouble moving the ball to finish your divorce or paternity matter? Child support or maintenance payments causing trouble with your salary cap? Sue Cannon is an experienced family law attorney who can coach you through mediation or fire a pass into the end zone at trial. To make an appointment in Antioch, Huntley, or Lake Zurich with Susan E. Cannon and Associates, their number is 847-847-7354.
Want to fight childhood asthma? Then fight it with a scrub brush and a hot soapy towel. Even in the neatest and tidiest homes, if there's so much as a crumb to eat or a drop to drink, household pests like bugs and mice will do all that they can to get it. Creepy crawlies like bugs and mice are unpleasant enough as it is, but they're more than just a nuisance for kids with asthma because they can actually trigger an asthma attack. So give them a whole lot of nothing. Sweep up crumbs, wipe down